Each of the groups within the Psy 2011 cohort were asked to come up with the proposed symposium topic. These were orchestral panels, some members of which we are lucky enough to have present with us today, and the idea with the most promise was declared the official 2016 symposium topic. Thus, from this point on, the entire cohort has been working tirelessly to present to you today the epidemic of irrationality. Inspired by anti-vaccination movements and the rise of Donald Trump, the symposium aims to improve understanding and bring greater insight to how irrational thoughts develop and why, despite being so absurd, spread so easily throughout entire populations. We believe that with a greater understanding of this topic, we, as future scientists, might be able to draw a clearer line between right and wrong, thus preventing the pro-Trump anti-vaccination beliefs of the world from causing such harm to our societies. In order to promote this understanding, we have arranged speakers from different backgrounds to provide a variety of perspectives on this topic. Our first speaker today was planned to be Ms. Megan Candle, but unfortunately she is unable to attend today due to illness and sends her apologies. In her stead, Mr. John Cook from the Global Change Institute here at UQ has very kindly agreed to give us a presentation on the irrationality of climate change denial on very short notice. Then, given Ms. Campbell's specialty of the mirror neuron system, the Galois Gunners, one of the Psy 2011 groups, will present about the mirror neurons to present the neuroscience perspective in her absence. Next, Dr. Paul Henman from the UQ School of Social Sciences will be presenting a sociological insight into the spreading of irrational thinking. Finally, Dr. Hans de Sterck will provide us with a mathematical approach to understanding this problem. Between Dr. Henman and Dr. de Sterck's approach to understanding presentations, we will be running a simple activity which aims to turn the concept of spreading of irrational thoughts from a mere theoretical issue to a clearer reality. Following the presentations, we will be holding a panel discussion where the audience is encouraged to ask any questions and share thoughts and opinions on today's topics. All in all, on behalf of the entire Psy 2011 cohort, we sincerely hope you enjoy the next few hours, which our dedicated committees have worked so hard to organise for you. We will now have a presentation about mirror neurons from the Psy 2011 group, the Galois Gunners, consisting of Emily, Kyle, and Tara, and Jocelyn. Please join me in making them feel welcome.
Its role in the epidemic of irrationality and the skepticism surrounding mirror neurons are important concepts that allow us to better understand our ability to learn and empathize. As for the understanding of mirror neurons, don't be fooled. This phenomenon is only just beginning to unfold. Discovered in the 90s, mirror neurons have mainly been studied in monkeys. It has been proposed that the mirror neuron system performs two functions. Firstly, mirror neurons are involved in transforming visual information into knowledge. So this would mean that when I see, say, Kyle yawn, my temporal cortex receives this visual information and creates a mode representation of it. This representation is then sent to my parietal mirror neurons, which further compiles a more detailed description of the observed movement. Then the information is relayed to my lower frontal cortex, where the observed movement becomes associated with the goal. In this case, the goal is to yawn out of tiredness or boredom. Imitation is a second proposed function wherein mirror neurons allow us to learn to perform others' actions through observation. The information is sent to the, back to the frontal cortex, from the frontal cortex back to the temporal lobe, mapped onto multiple motor cortex centers, and then translated into body movement, or in other words, IOM. Mirror neurons encompass several neuron types which respond to different stimuli. Studies with monkeys have shown that some mirror neurons exclusively display mirror-like responses when shown live content, while other neurons respond to video content. Some neurons only respond to specific types of action. Other neurons respond to a broader range of observations. There are neurons that are merely activated by the sound of a particular movement. There are also neurons that can be suppressed in response to observations. Touch-sensitive neurons can respond to the observations of being poked in, say, the rib. Importantly, researchers found that mirror neuron activity is modulated by other factors such as view angle, reward value of the observed movement, and goal of observation. Reward value refers to whether the observed movement is attractive and motivational to induce imitation. The goal refers to whether the observation is grasping objects or placing down objects, for instance. This finding suggests that the mirror neuron system relies not only on the sensory system, but also on the meaning of observations, formulations developed elsewhere in the brain through the cognitive system. Additionally, to perform actions, the motor system is required. Hence, along with the mirror neuron system, the motor, sensory, and cognitive systems interact, allowing us to imitate others' actions.
One use of mirror neurons in the brain is in the ideomotor system, as is seen in this diagram. This first model displays how a stimulus is perceived by our brain. We perceive both a stimulus and someone else's response to it, which then results in an effect. For example, say Tara's coffee was too hot, a stimulus, so she opens her hand as a response, and so the cup drops, and that's the effect. As an observer, we then begin to associate the effect with the stimulus. And eventually, in the final bit, we begin to associate the effect with the response, bypassing the stimulus entirely. Hence, through the ideomotor system, over time, we learn that when we open our hands, we want to drop something. This is possible as the ideomotor system does not draw a distinction between observing an action and imitating it, as is facilitated by mirror neurons. This enables observers to instinctually and immediately respond to what other people are experiencing. In fact, it is by these mirror neurons within the ideomotor system that this learning process facilitates higher order thinking. Neural empathy and mirroring depends on group association. This means that we form associations with people that we perceive to be similar to ourselves. We all essentially have an in-group, a group that we identify with, and an out-group, a group that we don't identify with, say, thrive versus reform. The group behavior associated with these groups are favoritism, conformity, and helping people who are in the in-group, whereas you feel prejudiced, discriminated against, and have conflicts with the people who aren't in your group. If one person has an irrational idea, the people in their group are more likely to accept it, as they are trying to conform with them. This is because the mirror neurons are more likely to fire in response to someone in the in-group, as opposed to someone in the out-group. Mirror neurons are also thought to be implicated with empathy. When the same pathway triggers in ourselves in response to another's problem, it enables us to see their problem from their perspective. However, this breaks down when people or groups of people are opposing us. We don't empathize, but further oppose ourselves to them.
So despite all this great knowledge and all these great theories, there are still many limitations and uncertainties that exist surrounding mirror neurons. Most significantly, although mirror neurons have been shown to exist in monkeys, and their function is well known and well understood, there is much less knowledge about human mirror neurons. So evidence of mirror neurons in a human brain has been found in non-motor areas, such as the temporal lobe, which controls hearing, language, and memory, as well as motor areas. However, due to the crude brain imaging equipment that we have currently available, individual neurons are difficult to observe in humans, and so it cannot be said with absolute certainty that mirror neurons do exist in humans as we know them in monkeys. In addition, a causal link is yet to be established between human brain activity and observation of actions. It is possible that this brain activity merely reflects action understanding and does not in fact contribute to it. Further, unlike monkeys, humans are capable of higher order thinking. This implies that mirror neuron functioning in humans may be much more complex and differ significantly from that of monkeys. Also, mirror neurons may only play a minor role in empathy. By definition, a mirror neuron is activated by the observation of an action. However, this system relies on one-to-one mapping between a goal and an action. However, in most situations, one-to-one mapping is inapplicable, meaning that the restriction function of mirror neurons would not allow us to fully understand actions. For example, if I fill a glass with water, I could be filling it to get a drink, to throw water at someone who is annoying me, or for a multitude of other reasons. In addition, humans are capable of empathy when indirectly observing a situation, such as when reading a book or a newspaper. In this situation, mirror neurons do not usually activate, although empathy can be felt. Hence, mirror neurons alone cannot be responsible for generating empathy. Nonetheless, most scientists feel comfortable with assuming that mirror neurons allow us to understand others' actions, as this has been shown to occur in monkeys. However, mirror neurons are still a long way off being confirmed and require much more in-depth research, as Megan was doing. Nevertheless, the mirror neuron system is still an entirely intriguing phenomenon that will no doubt shape our understanding of ourselves and how irrational thoughts spread.
Thank you, Kyle, Jocelyn, Tara, and Emily. Our next speaker is Climate Communications Fellow John Cook from the Global Change Institute here at UQ. John will be speaking to us about the climate change debate, particularly the irrationality of climate change denial. Please join me in welcoming John Cook.
So I guess my first question is, how will I get my PowerPoint slides up on the screen? Can someone help me with that? At the moment, and downloading or loading 538 every morning when I wake up to see how the polls are going. So the Trump movement is something that's been fascinating, and I think that there's a lot of psychological research that's quite relevant to explaining that and explaining climate science denial. Now, there's a study by the CSIRO who surveyed the Australian population, asking them about their views on climate change, and in one of their questions they asked people whether they believe climate change is happening or humans causing it and so on. And what they found was only 7% of Australians believe that climate change isn't happening. So it's a surprisingly small proportion of the Australian public. But one of the things really interesting is why does this proportion of the public don't even believe that climate change is happening? And the definitive research has actually been done here at the University of Queensland. Matthew Hornsey and Cali Fielding did a meta-analysis, or they just did a survey of all the different surveys into climate beliefs. And what they found was there's a whole range of different drivers of climate beliefs, but the biggest drivers are political ideology and political affiliation. And particularly affiliation, what political party you vote for was the biggest effect on what people thought about climate change and the greenhouse effect, which seems irrational at first glance. Like, why would, whether we vote Labor or Liberal, determine our views on the greenhouse effect? One should have nothing to do with the other. But there's a huge psychological relationship between the two. So why is that? And in fact, just the previous talk, talking about in-groups and out-groups, that's like the fact that it's political affiliation is that major driver. Just really drives home the fact that humans are social animals. We're tribal in nature, and so what tribe we belong to and what we think that tribe believes has a big influence on what we believe. But let's go a little deeper into why political ideology might drive climate beliefs. Now, there was a study done that they ran an experiment where they tested different messages on people to see what influence it would have on their climate beliefs. And they basically tested two types of messages. They presented some science about climate change, and then they followed up by saying the solution to climate change is a free market friendly solution. In other words, we need to do things like invigorate the nuclear industry, and that's the way to solve climate change. So they did that with one group, and then with another group, they said, well, climate change is happening exactly the same science. But then they said, the solution is government regulation. We need to regulate polluting industries and bring down pollution. So it was two completely different messages, two different completely different frames, but exactly the same science. And what they found was, amongst Democrats, either framing had pretty much the same effect. But they found that when they presented those two different framings to Republicans, that the free market friendly solution about invigorating the nuclear industry did okay, but government regulation had a big had very little influence at all. And so conservatives responded really negatively to messages about government regulation, even though the science communicated in all these different intervention was the same. And so what this tells us is that with conservative ideology, people who are politically conservative, a key aspect of that ideology is opposition to government regulation. Conservatives want a free, unregulated market. They want small government. They don't want the government regulating industries like the fossil fuel industry. They prefer that the market is free and unregulated. And so therefore, when you have science messages that conclude, therefore we need to regulate markets, they respond by rejecting science in the first place. So why does this matter? If only 7% of Australians don't believe climate change is happening, can't we just ignore that small proportion of the public? Now, in this survey, not only did they ask what people think about climate change, they also asked them what they thought other people think about climate change. So one question they asked was, what proportion of Australians do you think don't believe global warming is happening? And what they found was Australians think that 23% of the public don't believe global warming is happening. So in other words, even though the reality is only 7% of Australians deny climate change, people think that they're much, like three times larger than that. They're a much bigger slice of the Australian public. And they call this heuristic ignorance, the idea of a small but vocal minority being perceived to be much bigger than they really are. And the consequence of this is this vocal minority has a disproportionate influence on public views about climate change. Now, some UK scientists did an analysis of tens of thousands of articles by politically conservative think tanks. And what they did was they ran a content analysis on these thousands of articles and divided them up into articles that either attacked climate science or attacked climate policy. And what they found was over time, you would think that the debate, the public debate, should shift from attacking the science to gradually accepting the science and moving on to policy solutions. But they actually found the opposite, that over time, conservative groups were doubling down on their science denial. And so these small groups, a 7% small minority, was not only continuing to produce misinformation about climate science, they were doing it at an increasing rate. And what messages was this science denial about? They found another study looking at conservative articles about climate change, found that the number one argument against climate change or climate science was that there's no consensus, that there's no scientific agreement amongst climate scientists that humans are causing global warming. And this focus, this continued production of misinformation about the consensus, has had an impact. Now, the research that I published here at UQ a couple of years ago, I did analysis of climate papers about climate change, and I found that amongst papers that stated a position on human-caused global warming, 97% endorsed the consensus that humans were causing global warming. So amongst climate scientists who are publishing climate research, there's overwhelming agreement. But if you ask the general public how many climate scientists agree that humans are causing global warming, the average answer is 67%. So there's a big gap between what the public think and the actual 97% consensus. And this consensus gap matters. It has significant consequences. Because what people think about scientific expert opinion has a big influence on whether we think global warming is happening, what's causing it, and most importantly, should we do anything about it? If people don't think that the scientists agree, if they think there's a 50-50 debate, then they're less likely to support climate action. And how long have I got, by the way? I'm not sure. Should I be wrapping up? Okay. All right, so, and this matters because all these studies and information actually, but I hope I'm not going too quickly, but another study coming out of Princeton in the US tested what happens when people receive conflicting information. For one group in their experiment, they told them about the 97% consensus, and they found that for this group, perceived consensus, what they thought scientific agreement was, went up 27%. Telling people about the consensus has a positive effect on increasing their perceived consensus, which makes sense. But they also found that if you told them about the 97% consensus, but then also showed them some misinformation about the consensus, like misinformation designed to cast doubt on the consensus, the two pieces of information cancelled each other out, and there was no net effect. And this, normally when you run an experiment and you get a result, that's not statistically significant. It's not really a very exciting result. But in this case, it's actually quite significant in the fact that what this means for science communicators and scientists is even if we communicate our science and communicate it well and get the message out to the public, misinformation can cancel out the good effect of science, accurate information. And so we don't live in a world where it's just us, not scientists, communicating accurate science to the public. There is also many sources of misinformation that are also proactively putting misinformation out to the public. And so the danger is that the accurate information from scientists and the misinformation can cancel each other out. And that's why we see it, that only 67% people think there's only 67% consensus. So what do we do about that? And I guess one of the key sort of questions about the topic of irrationality is what can we do about it? And what this study found was the answer to irrationality is possibly not trying to like cure irrationality or trying to necessarily take those truck supporters or those climate deniers or people who are really hardcore science deniers or strongly irrational. Rather, they tested an alternative approach. They found that if you told people the accurate science about the consensus, but then you gave them an inoculation message, and I'll explain what that is in a moment, and then showed them the misinformation, the inoculation, to a certain degree, neutralized the misinformation. And so what do I mean by inoculation? While I was doing my PhD, I conducted some experiments and I presented the experimental results at a psychology conference. And a professor came up to me afterwards and he said, "What you're doing sounds a lot like inoculation theory." And I was like, "What's inoculation theory?" And so I dived into the books and I found out that inoculation theory was a branch of psychological research dating back to the 1950s. And since then, it's been 60 plus years of research into this idea. And inoculation theory borrows the concept of vaccination or inoculation and applies it to knowledge. Now, with vaccination, the idea is you can stop the disease from spreading by exposing people to a weak form of the disease. And in inoculation theory, what they found was you can stop misinformation from spreading by exposing people to a weak form of the misinformation. And so an inoculation message really has two elements to it. Firstly, you need to explain the science. You still need to explain the facts to people. But in addition, you also need to explain how that science might be distorted. What are the techniques used to distort scientific facts? And so this is a good summary of what the psychological research tells us is the most effective ways to both to debunk myths or to inoculate people against misinformation. You need to present the facts, you need to explain the science as clearly, as simply as possible, make the science as sticky and memorable as possible. You also need to introduce people to myths that try to distort the science. But when you do that, what you're doing is you're presenting people two conflicting pieces of information, a fact and a myth. And as one of the slides I showed you earlier shows, when you present people with two conflicting pieces of information, they cancel each other out. So the way you resolve that conflict is then you need to explain the fallacies that the myth uses to distort facts. And then what they're able to do is resolve that conflict. They can understand how the facts and the myths both exist at the same time. Does that make sense? All right. So we've taken that approach, that inoculation approach, and boiled down into this a massive open online course that we ran at the University of Queensland, Making Sense of Climate Science Denial. And what we've done is we've taken 50 of the most common myths about climate change and identify the key facts related to each myth, and basically structure it as a telling the story of climate change, and then debunking all the most common myths along the way. And with each myth, we explain what technique the myth used to distort the science. And so what we're doing is really giving people 50 flu shots against all the most common myths about climate change. And I think that's it. But also the MOOC, Massive Open Online Course, the latest version of it, just launched 10 o'clock this morning. So if you want to check it out, it's something you can just enroll for free, and the URL is at the top. So if there's time, I'd be happy to answer any questions. Yes?
Do you think that inoculation of rationality is enough to deal with the predominance of ideologically driven, like you're treating irrationality with rationality, but I guess my question is, do you know if it works? I mean, what's the evidence for it actually working in actually changing anybody's ideological mind or position?
Unfortunately, I didn't include any slides of the research I've published, but I've
run a few. It's logical, but.
So I've run a few inoculation studies, but I think that, that he's kind of a poster boy for that idea, if you want. I mean, that's very anecdotal. It's such a small sample that you can't really study them statistically anymore.
Is there different ways of applying the manipulation theory to different audience? Versus general public versus like more academic intellectuals?
Yeah, that's a good question. I've done workshops on this idea and improving critical thinking from scientists to adults to middle school students. So I know some researchers who are even working at the primary level. So I think that it's promising that this can work at all levels, but that's something that there needs to be a lot more research to investigate.
Is it possible that the causation of political affiliation is reversed? So people who don't believe climate change have all chosen the same party to support, as opposed to supporting a party causes their belief of non-belief of climate change?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. And with the challenge with psychological research is when you run surveys, you're observing correlations between a political belief and a climate belief. But a survey done in an instant in time doesn't tell you which way the causation goes. But the way psychologists can tease out causal relationships is through randomized experiments. If you divide people into random groups, and you apply a stimuli, then you can better see what cause there is. And that's why this experiment that I showed right at the beginning was a good way of looking at the causal effect, because it was by applying the stimuli of this, either a political, two different kind of political framings, it showed that people who held to a certain political belief responded to the science message in a different way. So it was their political ideology driving the way they updated their scientific beliefs. Yeah?
Have you observed any sort of chronic effects of inoculations, or are they just mean give someone the tools to solve and then give them straight after? Or do you see how that effect, where that effect continues
right
for the next few months?
Yeah, I mean, that's a really important question. The experiments that I've done being an instant in time, you really do need to look at it longitudinally over time. And with inoculation, there's been a couple of studies generally, not climate denial, but general inoculation studies, and they've really found that just the same as the whole idea of vaccination, you really need booster shots. You need to keep inoculating people over time to keep that effect going. So, and with the MOOC, we've actually collected people's views at the start of the course, at the end of the course, and then a month after the course. So that's data we haven't looked at yet, but it's something that I think we can explore how the effect carries over time and whether you need to keep giving people booster shots. It's a good question. Thanks very much.
Please welcome Associate Professor Paul Henman. Well, thank you very much for the organisers for inviting me to participate in this symposium. I first want to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners on the land which the UQ stands, the Turrbal Jagera people and their custodians past and present. One of the things I like about the symposium is the way in which you brought multiple disciplines together to help us to think about a problem, an issue across different disciplines, because by looking multidisciplinary, we can learn more, having new insights into the situation at hand. We just talked about the issue of psychology and focusing on the individual, to look at neurology, focusing on the brain. When we think about sociologically, seeing at the level of societies or groups. I myself actually did my first degree in computer science and pure maths and a science degree before coming and doing a degree in sociology. So I've worked a lot in the multidisciplinary area and it's very rewarding. So about irrationality. We may see a lot of these comments such as creationism, global warming as a hoax, and anti-vaxxers around questions of irrationality. But we need to begin to start to understand what we mean by irrationality, what we mean by irrationality. And the very modern idea of scientific rationality is quite new. I want to use an illustration from Monty Python to actually help us to think about what is the nature of thought, what is the nature of reasoning, and what is the nature of rationality. Whoops. Decided to not play a game. Play well. There it is.
Quick! And what you heard apart from witches?
More witches!
Good. So, why do witches burn? Because I'm in good food.
Oh, yeah.
So, how do we tell whether she is made of wood?
Build a bridge out of her.
Ah, but can you not also make bridges out of stone?
Oh, yeah.
Does a wood sink in water?
No, it floats. It floats over into the bowl.
What also floats in water?
Brain. Apples, very small rocks, cider, a great gravy, cherries, none, a church, leg, a duck.
Exactly. So, logically, if she weighs the same as a duck, she's made of wood, and therefore,
logic about a witch, but the logic and reasoning of the medieval period was a logic and reasoning by analogy. And we still do reasoning by analogy all the time. When we look back to history to try to learn about the present, we're doing analogy. When we look at someone's behaviour by comparing it, predicting it from someone else's behaviour, we're reasoning by analogies. And now there's nothing wrong with that, but as you can see, that reasoning by analogy doesn't make sense to the modern mind. We can't dismiss people in that reasoning as stupid, because they are intelligent people in the medieval period. But what is it that makes us different in today's world and the way in which we think helps us to understand what we see as rational compared to 500 years ago versus the rationality of the day. It also helps to think about, understand and challenge the ways in which what we think is rational for our thinking compared to others' thinking. So these questions about rationality also come to touch on questions of what is truth. So what counts as truth when we make truthful statements? Go back to the question of evolution and creationism. In a sense, the focus on creationism is an outcome of a scientific worldview that's merged with a religious worldview that's in conflict.
Sorry.
The creation story can be a true story in that it can be a statement about the world, not in a scientific sense, but in a theological sense or in a meaning sense. We don't dismiss indigenous stories of the rainbow serpent as not true. We may say they're not scientifically true, but they're culturally true. When I say to someone, I love you, is that a scientific statement of truth? How can we test it? So these kind of forms of statements about what is truth claims, we need to think about what does count as true. When we say these are irrational, we're saying something about their truthfulness. But we're using a specific kind of truthfulness. We're using a scientific form of truthfulness. And we need to understand the nature of truth and rationality to understand and appreciate what we might call irrationality. Now, the birth of the modern mind and the modern forms of reasoning is very interesting in terms of the way in which we've come to be the types of thought that we have. Now, I'm interested in the ways in which material devices help to shape and structure the way in which we are. Now, the birth of the modern mind can be developed over a range of things, but I want to highlight the role of the printing press. Gutenberg developed it in the mid-1400s, but its impact on society and our modernity is something that occurs over the coming centuries. Now, Elizabeth Eisenstein has written a two-volume work around the creation of the modern mind as a result of the printing press. But what does the printing press do? It creates a capacity to disseminate the written word that is far beyond what was previously there. It also creates a capacity for standardization. Errors in reproduction or changes in the processes of reproduction do not occur like they did with the scribal culture. It also means that there is a preservation that you can compare and contrast. So what does this mean? What does it do for the ways in which the thoughts were occurring? Well, firstly, language or knowledge can be distributed, and clearly the Bible was one of the key things that came to be distributed. It came to be distributed in a way that was published in the local dialect, not just Latin. And by publishing in the local dialect, people who increasingly were becoming to be more literate were able to read Bible themselves. They didn't get their theological knowledge through the priests anymore. It came from their own reading and scholarship. So it undermined the Catholic elite. It undermined the creation of the holy idea of knowledge of religion, of Christianity, through the papal see and through the clergy, directly to the people. It also helped to demystify this, because the process of knowing was not mediated through this hierarchy. It also led to the capacity to recognize that there were not one Bible, but many Bibles. There were very different, that had different statements or verses in it that had occurred over time. And then that led to biblical scholarship, to seek to understand and interpret it. No longer was it a book that somehow had an aura of unquestionability to it. It, like any literature, could be investigated and considered. We also see the level of growth of public knowledge, not knowledge of elites, but a growth of public knowledge and the growth of individual thought as a result. And it led to new social groupings between people beyond the local community that people found themselves, to new connections in scholarship. And by doing so, it provided the basis for the development of scientific thought, the questioning, the critical, the comparisons, and historical inquiry. Now, keeping as this theme, we see the role of the media, of the communication information technologies, in the way in which we shape knowledge. And as we move from the early modern period through to the growth of nations in the 18th and the 19th centuries, we see that the mass media has become particularly important for the creation of a national identity and the formation of very boundaries between nations. It solidifies national languages through the ways in which authoritative spelling occurs and through dictionaries. It also is the mass circulation of messages, especially with the state ownership of the mass media. It's used to create and reinforce ideologies and modes of thought, exclusionist ideologies, and the mapping of boundaries, which can be quite contested. So the significance of the mass media is that high levels of production of knowledge are held in those who have the capacities of the producers of that knowledge, the technical capacity. It is a one-to-many device. We're able to one person or one groups of people distribute to many. Let's move on to the mass social, the contemporary period of social media and the post, what we might call postmodern knowledge. Here we have social media is not one to many, it is many to many. We can communicate to many people, and many people can communicate to many other people. It's not that one to many device that we have. But it's led to some interesting dynamics. Here we have a feed from the Wall Street Journal has put together this, what we call blue feed, red feed. And it looks, and you can go to that website on the Wall Street Journal, and it has live Twitter feeds for both liberals, people who are identified as liberal on Facebook, and people who identify as conservative on Facebook, liberal being the left-wing version of the term in the US and Australia's terminology. Under the postings of guns from yesterday, we have on the left-hand side, Trump completely snaps and braces unhinged. Oh no, the Illuminati is coming for your guns and your freedoms, and Hillary Clinton is leading the way, so sarcastic comment there. On the right-hand side, the conservatives are tweeting, UN says, or sharing, UN says they will soon occupy America because of the Fifth Amendment that Hillary is apparently going to get rid of. We have very different worldviews of the same thing that's going on. So this is what we might call echo chambers, knowledge echo chambers. Now, it's long been understood that we tend to congregate and associate with people who are like us, have similar economic backgrounds, similar educational levels. And we also read publications that are similar to our views. It's long been observed in the media. It's now that's in the social media we see this happening in a much more extended and accelerated way. So we tend to read views that reinforce rather than challenge our perspective. So social networks are part of this because we form social networks that are on our hearts, that are like us. But we increasingly have algorithms that reinforce that. Facebook algorithms that give us the trending news that they think that we want to hear is reinforcing the idea that the world around us is what everybody sees, but it's really our own world reinforced back to us. And also, finally, the social media allows for this fast flow of information that's always being updated, which allows for little consumption of critical thought. So let's go back to the idea of what is rational and what is true. Rationality and paradigms. Thomas Kuhn wrote a classic book about the structure of scientific revolutions. Now, there have been some criticisms about the empirical accuracy of it, but Kuhn was arguing that even in the world of science, there are paradigms of thought that seek to filter out certain types of knowledge or data or evidence that doesn't meet our expectations, to downplay it. And it is through the building up and building up of certain types of evidence and the changes in the social or the training of scientists that can lead to changes in the knowledge that occurs. And this seems quite strange, given that we think as scientists we're very rational and we change our view just by the giving of evidence. But Kuhn is arguing that this is not entirely the case. John Maynard Keynes, famous macroeconomic, said, when the facts change, I change my mind. What do you do, sir? The reality is that we do not change our minds based on the facts. Our modes of thought are shaped by the paradigms that we live in. And just as that example of that climate science and the way in which we should respond helps to illustrate that. And it's no surprise that the United States, amongst the rich countries, have a very negative attitude to the state than any other country, rich country in the world. And so states are not to be trusted. So this leads us to thinking about, well, what is truth? How does truth operate when we think about paradigms? Michel Foucault, who a famous, most famous 20th century social theorist, said that truth can be understood as a system of ordered procedures for the production, regulation, distribution, circulation, and operation of statements. Think about that statement when we look back at Monty Python's question of reasoning about how do you tell someone is a witch. You can see that the statements in how do you tell someone is a witch can fit in a logical pattern that flow through giving of the evidence and reasoning. It doesn't fit with our understanding of scientific truth because we have different forms of reasoning and modes of production of knowledge. But truth is also part of a system of power. It's a system of power in who can say what is true. How do we determine what is true? And we need to be alert to these systems of power when we understand the epidemic of irrationality. So what does this mean? So if we are to understand the epidemic of irrationality, we first must understand the social construction of truth. I'm not saying that those things are not irrational. They are irrational from a scientific mindset. But if we want to suggest otherwise to our meaning-making, challenges us to the core. And so we need to understand how that core has been constructed. So just an example of the way in which language is used in different ways. On the left-hand side, we have two different statements about silence-seeking. One, they are cue jumpers. One, they're exercising their human right. What are they constructing about the world? Why is it the knowledges that are embedded within those constructions are being made? We also see politicians. Don't get any sort of form of knowledge or truth from politicians, but we see Joe Hocking talking about these. This was about the interest rate levels. He called the interest rate cuts by the Independent Reserve Bank going to emergency levels. And because the Labor Party is failing to manage the Australian economy. Then when he's now Treasurer, he says that those interest rate cuts are good news for families and small businesses. In fact, the interest rate cuts that he's talking about on the second hand is actually lower than in the first time. Similarly, the debt and deficit disaster was a problem. I'll give you another example of a bout of irrationality. Who knows about voting with both face? Well, who doesn't know about voting with both face? Everyone does, okay, good. Okay, so Brexit is another example of potentially of irrationality. Doesn't make sense, because even though the people, the architects of Brexit probably didn't know what they were thinking about, what did they actually mean? So why is it that people voted for something that they don't really know or can't expect what the meaning of it is? So if we want to respond to the epidemic of reality, of irrationality, we must first identify and challenge the social, political and economic drivers for truth claims. The role of corporations that fund certain forms of knowledge creation and hide others. And this is Big Pharma, is big case in point of that. The role of corporations and the mass media in emphasising certain knowledges and downplaying others. The first thing, the thing I go back to that discussion about climate denial, it's important to note that climate denial is only seems to be occurring amongst Anglophone countries, where Rupert Murdoch owns a lot of the mass media, and also where there is high levels of coal interests, etc. So you can begin to ask the question, why is that the case? So it's not that climate change denial is something that is evenly spread across the OECD or the rich world. It's something that is peculiar. So that shows that the social construction of irrationality is different in different places. So we also need to know the role of social actors in deliberately circulating false knowledge. And for example, Obamacare, if you've been around or remember long enough, when Obama first came and introduced the reforms to the health insurance in the United States, it was the terrible thing it was actually originally a policy idea that was implemented by the Republican government, state government. That's how terrible it was. You have to be. The Republicans voted against something that their own party had developed. And the people who were against Obamacare were largely the groups of people who would benefit from Obamacare. A level of irrationality. And Marx would play, Pat would call that, Marx would have said the role of capital or the role of the powers, the money people, in creating false consciousness. And finally, when we think about the epidemic response to the epidemic irrationality, if we understand rationality and truth from understanding how people make their meaning, we need to understand how truth has as a meaning-making and has emotional dimensions. We can't simply argue the case and hope people change their minds. We need to understand the role of truth to people. For example, people tend to create world, try to create stability in an unstable world. The creation of social communities, especially one under threat, is something that we see. And in a world of highly unequal society, the identification of migration, of difference, becomes something to be as threat. And so that also helps to explain the rise of Donald Trump. Donald Trump is not something that's appeared out of nowhere. The conservative machinery have fed those types of thoughts for many years, and now it becomes almost untenable for them. But it also means we need to engage with people respectfully, not as an argument or as idiots or to denigrate them. We need to understand where they've come from if we want to try to address the epidemic of irrationality. So including, I want to just play another Monty Python video, The Argument Thing.
Is this my wrong mum? I've told you once. Wait, just now. Hey, yes I did.
I didn't tell you, I...
You did not!
I'm sorry, is this a 5 minute or a little full half hour?
Oh, just a 5 minute one.
Thank you. Anyway, I did.
You most certainly did not.
Now, let's get one thing right here. I most definitely told you.
You did not.
Yes, I did.
You did not.
Yes, I did.
Didn't.
Yes, I did.
Didn't.
Yes, I did.
No, this is an argument.
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't. It's just contradiction.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
It is not.
It is. You just contradicted me.
No, I didn't.
Oh, you did.
No.
You did. Just
no,
then.
No, nonsense.
Oh, but this is futile.
No, it isn't.
I gave you a good argument.
No, you didn't. You gave me an argument.
Well, an argument's not the same as contradiction.
Capping?
No, it can't! An argument is a collective series of statements to establish a definite proposition.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is! It isn't just contradiction.
Look, if I argue with you, I must take up a contrary position.
But it isn't just saying no, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't! Argument's an intellectual process. Contradiction is just the automatic gainsaying of anything the other person says.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is!
Not at all.
No, look,
thank you.
What?
That's it. Morning.
I was just getting interested.
Sorry, 5 minutes ago.
That was never 5 minutes just now.
Afraid it was.
No, it wasn't.
Sorry, I'm not going to argue anymore.
What?
If you want me to go on arguing, I'll have to pay for another 5 minutes.
But that was never 5 minutes just now. Oh, come on. This is ridiculous.
I'm very sorry, but I told you I'm not allowed to argue unless you paid.
Oh, all right. There you are.
Thank you.
Well?
Well, what?
That was never 5 minutes just now.
I'm not allowed to argue unless you paid.
I just paid.
No, you didn't.
I did! I did! But I can't argue about that.
I'm very sorry.
Aha! Well, if I can pay, why are you arguing? Gotcha.
There you have it.
Is that? If you're arguing, I ask me.
Not necessarily. Could be arguing in my spare time.
I've had enough of this.
There you have.
Oh, shut up.
Thank you very much.
Okay, yes, also from me, thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this workshop. I think the topic of the workshop is really a fascinating topic, and I'm very happy to be able to talk a little bit about some research that I've done with a PhD student of mine in this kind of general area, and maybe also to speculate a little bit about these ideas of epidemic of irrationality, how modern thought may spread sometime in this irrational way. So I'll talk about using mathematics to model social spreading processes in the era of big data. And so these are the topics that I will cover in the next half hour or so. So I'll talk a little bit about big data in our connected society and how it can potentially enable the study of social spreading processes. And then in particular, so I'm an applied and computational mathematician, so how can we help in contributing to studying these kind of processes. I will talk about two specific projects that my PhD student did. So one is about modeling civil unrest and the Arab Spring, and another is about modeling Ebola epidemics, which is not a spreading of thoughts, but I think a lot of the mathematical techniques that are used in that kind of context can also be applied to what would be the topic of today's workshop. I'll say a little bit about mathematical and computational techniques, just to summarize, and then I'll speculate a little bit about the epidemic of irrationality, why are some completely irrational ideas so infectious. I haven't worked on that specifically, but I think it's a very interesting topic, and maybe I'll sketch some possible ideas about how that could be studied. So big data in our connected society, I think, everybody is aware of that. There are these big online social networks, for example. So Twitter has now 313 million users, approximately. That's the latest numbers I could find. And more than 500 million tweets per day. So there's a lot of information flowing around the world. Facebook has almost 2 billion users, and people are connected in many different ways. They interact in many different ways. And the interesting thing in terms of, from point of view of trying to understand how ideas spread, is that all this information, because it's digital, is now available and is somewhere stored. Actually, I think these companies, they actually keep almost all of the data that has been produced. And so there is this unbelievable treasure of data that you can use to study these kind of processes these days. And then cell phones, for example, they can collect history of where you are, what you do, maybe even health-related questions. And this is actually a screenshot from my iPhone yesterday. And I don't know if you've ever opened this like little health app that Apple has, and I had only opened it once by accident. And then yesterday I did, because I knew it was there, and it's amazing. So it has been keeping track of how many steps I did per month or per week or per day, per year for the past few years, and I didn't even know about that. And it's interesting, so there were a few months in the past year when I went running, it seems, because I have a lot more stuff. And so I haven't been very good at keeping up my running, as you probably, it's a little unfortunate that you can kind of see that which months that was worth. But anyway, but it's amazing, so this data is now available on my phone, and I'm actually not sure if Apple also has this data. They may, because somewhere in the user agreement I may have clicked something that it's actually being sent to them or not. I don't even know, but probably from a lot of people, this kind of information is really available. So there's a lot of information available digitally that you can use to, for example, if you're interested in health behavior of people, this could be very very useful. So there is this treasure of data to study social spreading or other types of things happening in society, and I think, and that's kind of a new thing. So that's only in the past few years that this has become the case. But even more interesting, I think, just because people are now connected in these new ways, the way how ideas are spreading has become very different from before, I think. And so there is this very nice combination of, you have potentially data to study these things, and there's also a lot of very interesting things that you can study, partially because of this new connectivity. And I think that is really fascinating. And so there's a lot of people who start to realize that. For example, this is a person, Professor King. I think it's at Harvard. Yeah, he's heading this Institute for Quantitative Social Science, and he's arguing the social sciences are in the midst of an historic change, which large parts moving from the humanities to the sciences, in terms of research style, infrastructural needs, data availability, empirical methods, substantiating understanding, and the ability to make swift and dramatic progress where you can really demonstrate things quantitatively as well. And I think that's really very interesting. There are now also new conferences, for example, this conference on computational social science. This year was only the second time they did it, but there is starting to be a lot of interest in this. And this is at the intersection of this other buzzword these days, data science, which is doing things with lots of data, and social science. So there is a lot of opportunity. Now, my background is really not in this area of social spreading aspects at all. So my background is really large-scale numerical computing methods, and originally applied to fluid simulations for physics applications, and I'm still doing that as well. Then I moved into like optimization algorithms for big data and deep learning type of applications, maybe a bit more recently. And then also quite recently, so from 2011, I had a PhD student who was interested in these social spreading ideas, and we just decided, okay, let's try to do something in that area, because there are really interesting problems, and you really need an interdisciplinary approach to use make use of those opportunities. And he worked on four topics, so modeling civil unrest and the Arab Spring, a mathematical model about the smoking epidemic, about the obesity epidemic, and then in the last year or so about the spread of Ebola. And so I'll talk a little bit about two of those topics to just give an idea about what kind of mathematical techniques could be used to study this kind of social spreading processes. And so the work we did on the Arab Spring, so we started to do this in 2011, when actually there were those revolutions and everything was still fresh in the mind of people. And one really interesting thing is it true that new types of connectivity between people, for example, online social media, the cell phones, the videos that people can make and put on YouTube and things like that, does that really have an influence on social processes and, in this case, the stability of political regimes? And you can certainly make hypotheses like that, but is it possible to gain some kind of quantitative understanding about this? And so are the dynamics of revolutions tied to the underlying social network connectivity and processes? And so we did some work on that, and so we made mathematical models that we applied to networks. And so one of the networks that we focused on was the type of Facebook networks, where typically people are connected to other people, and it's possible to have a lot of connections. And the connectivity of these networks, because it's not restricted to people who live close to each other, for example, it's very international, it's not local. The connectivity of these kind of networks tends to be quite different from the connectivity of how social networks used to be before there was this mass online media. Now, one difficulty is that it's very hard to get historical information of how the networks used to be, like who talks to who and like how many people interact with, because those days there were no digital networks, and none of that has been restored or even has been stored or even sampled. So what we did then is we compared the online modern networks with what we think may be a proxy for like how networks used to be maybe 30, 40 years ago. And that's what we call a physical contact network, which can these days also be constructed using cell phones, for example. Like cell phones, it can register where you are, and you can kind of track how close people get physically to each other. And if you can, for example, say if they're within a few meters from each other, then you assume they interact with each other. So this is actually a network in a high school, I think, a few thousand students. So try to reconstruct like who talks with whom and what kind of connections you have. And so then we can make comparisons between how things work on traditional networks and how things work on the new online social network. And this is definitely not perfect, but this is like one way to approach this kind of question. And then we did some kind of model for the propagation of information or the propagation of this revolution on these social networks. And we looked a little bit at conflict theory, and there is this work by Kuran in 1999 where it's argued that the decision to join the revolution is really a collective active problem. So if enough people actually participate, then the regime may not be able to do much. But if you're just a few people who do that, then it's very easy for the regime to repress the movement. And so that's what is called the collective action problem. So when is it the right time to actually join the revolution? And so we modeled that on our network, which is one of these empirical networks, using what we call a linear threshold model. So the nodes are individuals on the network, and we assume that everybody can see of the people they know, or can know of the people they know, if they are part of the revolution or not, and they cannot see anything else. So there is this kind of censor. There is only communication through the network. And then we say, as time goes by, if a large enough fraction of the neighbors of a node become active in the revolution, then that node may decide to become active as well. If we assume we are in a situation where the regime is very unpopular and everybody would actually join the revolution if they would know it would be successful and it would be safe to do so. Okay? And so there is this threshold theta, which is the fraction of neighbors. And then we kind of do a stochastic simulation, randomly we select changes in this network where people turn from inactive to active. And then at the same time, we also have what we call a decay process in the size of the revolution, where we say a node will return to inactive state if the police can basically be effective in repressing the revolution. And we say this will only happen as long as the revolution is not bigger than a certain size. If there is more than 20% of the people on the streets, then the government basically cannot do anything anymore. Okay, so then the decay process will stop. So we have this kind of mathematical model, we use stochastic simulations, and then depending on, because for each of these, you can kind of define time scales and things like that. Depending on the parameters, you may, for example, start with 20% of your population infected, and then in this case, it doesn't grow very much, and it kind of stays there, and so the revolution is not successful, where R is the fraction of the population, part of the revolution. And these gray states, they are like random stochastic simulations, so some of them actually become fully realized, but most of them don't. And then the solid black line and the dashed line, those are solutions of equations that kind of try to give models of what happens on such a real network, but in a way that is much easier to analyze, that we can try to understand for which parameters would actually the revolution succeed, and for which would it die out or stay somewhere on a low activity rate. And then some of those models are better than others, and so we did quite a bit of work on this. And this is on a Facebook network. And so we derived these simple ordinary differential equation models for the analysis. So it would just be a differential equation like this. I don't think I'll go through the details very much. We can justify this using graph theory and probability from the original stochastic model on the network. And then we can kind of, depending on the parameters in the model, which is how visible does the revolution have to be before people, or how big does the revolution have to be before people start to join the revolution? That's this parameter alpha. And how strong is the police repression? So how large does the revolution have to be before the police kind of gives up? That's the parameter beta. And then we can study all possible solutions of these equations and how they divide possible types of behaviors in different classes, and then we can define something what we can interpret as a stable police state, a meta-stable police state, an unstable police state, a failed state, and things like that. And so mathematically we can try to understand what kind of behavior is possible on that kind of network. Okay. And then one thing we can do, for example, on the Facebook network, if we have a very small initial condition of people who are part of the revolution, 0.01, 1% would be here, then we can see that on this Facebook network, it would actually spread quite well, so it would reach 90% or 80%, even with a very small initial seed. Whereas on the physical contact network, we find that you need a quite a bit larger initial infection to be successful. And that's kind of an indication or a first indication that these political revolutions may spread more readily on the online, like the new types of network, than the offline social networks. Now, this will require more investigation in terms of trying to understand why this is so. What is it about the new networks that makes it easier for things to spread than the old networks? And that is work that is still going on. Another thing is that you can try to merge these models to real events or real data. So for example, this is from 2011, I think, social network data from Twitter. So this is the amount of tweets as a function of time that mentioned the hashtag Egypt. And then depending on where the tweets were sent from, so you see it really kind of exponentially grow and then be large when the revolution is ongoing and things like that. And if you have that kind of data, you can try to estimate like how fast do things grow, and maybe you can try to match your theoretical model to what happens in the real world. Okay? And for example, there were 4 days in Egypt when they shut down the internet, so there were very little tweets, at least locally then at that time. But then afterwards, there was a lot of activity again. Okay? And so basically, in our model, we have these parameters C1 and C2, which kind of tell how fast two things grow or decay. We don't really know what the good numbers for that would be. And the alpha and the beta, like how strong is the police and how much does it take before people, how big does the revolution have to be before people will join. And if you kind of would be able to match this to the real data, then maybe you could try to estimate those parameters. Okay? And we did a little bit of that here, which is like, if this is the revolution as a function, the size of the revolution as a function of time, you can try to make some models where you have these political events, and then you can argue that maybe some of these parameters change. Like, for example, here, when the army refuses to act, then maybe this policing strength actually goes down. And you can come up with some things that you may try to look like it resembles this, but a lot of that is kind of ad hoc. If you would be able to do this with a lot of data, then you may be able to actually, this would be a hypothesis, and then test your hypothesis with real data, just like in the scientific method, really, but now applied to science. And we haven't really been able to do that because to get access to this data, which is in principle available, is actually not easy. So those companies have that data, but it's difficult to get your hands on. Okay? But I think there is a lot of potential for that. You could argue that maybe Egypt moves from a stable police state to a meta-stable police state to an unstable police state, and the revolution eventually was successful. And that would all be interesting to do with the data. And then, of course, you can also try to have models, because this was for the events in 2011, like all the things that happened afterwards, which were even much more complicated, I think. You can try to understand those things as well. Okay, so then this second topic is the modeling of the Ebola epidemics. I'm going to make a quick switch to something that was on the computer, because I don't have internet on my laptop here. So this is a movie of basically reconstructing how in the recent outbreak of Ebola in West Africa,
right.
Like where did it, what's up?
That's linked to your laptop, so you're showing this from your laptop now?
No, this is actually from the computer.
From the computer, so you're linking these then?
Yes. Yes, and I have to start with it, so maybe I'll do that. And then you see basically how the virus basically spreads. Like, it spreads kind of locally, and that makes these big jumps. And then locally again, from where it jumps from, it spreads. And so the way how people were able to reconstruct it is quite amazing. So they, when people die, they take a DNA sample of the actual virus. And the Ebola virus, in that short time, it does mutations. And by tracking the mutations, they can basically track back from where the virus came from, which is really quite amazing. And so you have this kind of, it's like a mix of like local effects, like if somebody gets infected, like the people around it can get infected too, but you also have these big jumps, right? And so, I'll play it one more time. So basically, it starts somewhere here, and then there's a lot of spreading locally. And then there are a few, and again, that is because, so one of the questions is why was the Ebola outbreak more severe recently than it was like tens of years ago? And maybe part of it is because people become more mobile, so they can travel further, they can go to funerals in places that are far away, and then the disease can be spread much more. Okay. And so if you want to try to model this kind of, in this case, disease spreading effects, then let me switch back to the laptop. Yes. So we have this wave-like behavior locally, long-distance jumps, and we have this hot and spread dynamics, that's what we call it. And in order to try to theoretically understand this, and maybe also try to find out like what can you do to influence this kind of spreading and maybe to control it better, one thing that people often do is they generate random networks, and in this case there is a clear spatial structure, and try to have models of how these things spread on these networks. And we came up with a random spatial network, so if there are nodes U and V in the network, then the probability that node is connected to U and V is proportional to like what we call the degree of U, which is like how many neighbors U has, and the degree of V. And then some spatial kernel, which tells us how likely is it to be connected to somebody close by, and how likely is it to be connected to somebody further away. And so by playing with this spatial kernel mathematically, by modeling that, you can add some global connections, far away connections, to the local connections that definitely exist. And for example, it's interesting to compare this with how the plague spread in medieval Europe. It's really believed that that just was like a big wave, because there were not those really long-range connections very much at that time. Okay, so we can play with those things in these kind of models, and then basically we can see if there are no long-range connections, we just get this like traveling wave kind of behavior locally. So there's lots of nodes connected, but all locally in these kind of simulations. And then if we have some long-range connections, then we can have these jumps that start their own like new nucleus from where the disease spreads, and that is like a theoretical mechanism for the hot and spread dynamics that we present. And we also observe these waves. Then you can also, again, because those were stochastic simulations, you can also derive equations to try to understand these things better. I'm not going to explain how that works in detail. You can compare your stochastic simulations, which are the black dots, with the actual differential equations that you get, and get a good match. And then you can make your own movie, and this is just in a square box, because mathematicians like to kind of make things abstract, but you could imagine having a network on the map of Western Africa and do something like this. And then you see that it's kind of spreads like a wave, but there are these secondary places where the epidemic jumps to. And so what we basically have here is a model that allows us to have like a theoretical description of this kind of thing. And so our model is versatile enough that you can actually put it on the map of the country. You can take into account density of population, like how much people in the city tend to interact with people in the city or with people on the countryside and things like that. You can have, in principle, travel networks, like how often people travel from one city to another, and you can really try to do simulations like that. Of course, we haven't done much of those more practical things yet, but I think there's a lot of possibility. So then, in terms of mathematical and computational techniques, there may be a few mathematics or physics majors here in the audience, but there's a lot of mathematics that goes into this. So this is very interdisciplinary work. So it's a bit like data science or computational science and engineering, computational social science. So you need these technical tools, you need a lot of programming like MATLAB or Python or R or distributed computing if, for some of these problems. And you also need a real interest in the actual application problem, like either the revolutions or the disease propagation, or things like that. And so one example of where this kind of research is going on in Australia is the people at the University of Adelaide. They have a project called Beta News in what is a data to decisions cooperative research center. For example, Professor Dr. Lewis Mitchell is active in that, he's in mathematics. And they actually collect all the Australian tweets. So they just make a big database of all the Australian tweets. I put the dollar sign here because I told you that it's sometimes hard to get your hands on to this data, which in principle would allow you to do very interesting basic research, but the companies are very protective of that. In this case, you actually have to pay them money. It's like a few $10,000 per year, I think they have to pay to actually get access to the data. And then you can, yeah, formulate this kind of projects like civil unrest prediction using social media data, like the Twitter data, real-time political polling via sentiment analysis on social media, like the kind of words people use, and then see how that correlates with political outcomes. Detecting anomalous events in your Twitter data, quantifying the effects of the mass media on the societal events, like if the government announces something, now people can organize very, very quickly and try to react to it because of the social media. And so they have a lot of honors and PhD projects available, and actually there may be some projects that could be done together with them. And I'm still building up my own research group at Monash. I only moved to Monash about a year ago, and so I also have a lot of honors and PhD projects available in these kind of areas. Okay, so now in the last 4 or 5 minutes, the epidemic of irrationality. So how do ideas spread, and why are some completely irrational ideas so infectious? Those are very interesting questions. First disclaimer, I have not really worked on this, especially on the aspect of irrational ideas, but I'm definitely interested in it. I've worked on this propagation of revolutions, which is somewhat related to this, but irrational ideas is also very interesting. So how does a computational mathematician approach these questions? So the first step should really be talk to experts in social science, psychology. We had some very good examples of that today. Biology, history, or at least read the relevant literature, or in my case, ask your PhD student to do so, because a lot of different things we have to do, right? And the disclaimer too is I have not really done this yet, even though I would be interested in doing that. Still, I am an interdisciplinary mathematical scientist, been interested in this area, so I can speculate about some reasonable hypotheses, and I can think about how this could be researched in a quantitative way. So we don't have to be afraid, we don't have to be shy, let's just try that. And also, now that we have big data, we can try to apply the scientific method. So the scientific method is a method of procedure that has characterized natural science since the 17th century, consisting in systematic observation, measurements, and experiments, and the formulation, testing, and modification of hypotheses. I think we can all do all of that. In particular, we have a lot, there is, in principle, a lot of data now. Experiments may be a little harder to do with people in the real world, but still, I think there are some things that can be done. So why are some completely irrational ideas so infectious? And I added a little addition today because, I mean, people mentioned Trump and things like that, so it looks really quite crazy these days, right? And then some potential hypotheses. How does network structure? Because the structure of the network is completely different if you have a gatekeeper that controls all the information. The structure is completely different. How does that influence the spread of controversial ideas? I think that is interesting. Also, the configurability and self-organization of networks, and also the way by changing communication protocols. So now in Twitter, you can communicate to everybody instantly, all of your followers. That's very different from, and the network can self-organize immediately. That's very different when you have a few fixed gatekeepers, right? So success of reality show tactics in politics, I think it's related to that. They kind of create an audience for themselves. and growth of organized extremism, right, civil unrest. So a research topic would be, how do network configurability and propagation protocols influence the spread of these controversial ideas? Another interesting thing is, I think, polarization versus consensus. A lot of discussions these days are very contentious, and we're even for or against. And maybe it has always been like that. Maybe we should talk to historians to know if that is really different. But I think there have been a lot of elections that ended up, and or even like the Brexit vote, on being very close to 50-50, so the public had just completely polarized. And in political systems where there used to be many parties of like equal strength, these days it turns out in many cases that in the end it's like two parties who go against each other, and the rest is just decimated. So there are these interesting hypotheses, because But I think they are interested to study. Influence of declining economy also, like the World War II things that has been related to declining economy. We have to talk to historians to see, is that important now? May that be a reason why these irrational ideas today may spread fast? That's what Paul was saying, I think, when communities are under threat, there may be this kind of reaction. And internationalizations of norms and values because of this globalization, global communication. Like, now symbols are completely illegal in France, but are completely okay in the US. Depicting religious figures is completely unheard of in Muslim countries, but somewhere else would be completely okay. Like, headscarves in schools in France would be completely off in the US. In other countries, they are not. So there is a lot of things that are changing because of this international communication, I think. And also the group dynamics and leadership processes. So I think it's easier to manipulate things in present-day networks, the way how things can be organized. And then once you can do that, then maybe there are these group dynamics kind of things that just let people flock to these kind of irrational ideas, people with irrational ideas. And for that, you would probably have to talk to biologists or to sociologists. And yeah, because people, and this is my last slide, because people now communicate without gatekeepers in a self-organized manner and very quickly, the system may also be more unstable, so you can get much faster and much bigger changes, and that's also very interesting to study. For example, that also happens economically, of course, with currency crisis and international economic crisis. And yeah, another thing is time scales of political decision making, like the 4-year election cycle that used to be adapted to how things worked before, but now that everything moves quicker, is that still the right thing to do? I don't know. So these kinds of questions can realistically be tackled by computational social science and big data these days, I think, if you can get access to the data. But in all this work, and I think it's the same in sociology or psychology work, asking the right questions, finding the right question to ask, given the data, is by itself a very difficult research challenge, because you want to get a conclusive result, not some kind of fluffy research where you don't really know what to think about it. But asking the right kind of questions is, and finding the right methodology to get a solid answer is really very important. I think there is a lot of opportunity there, and that's where I will finish.
Stage to combine their areas of expertise in an inclusive panel discussion. Additionally, I'd also like to invite Dr. Ethan Scott from the UQ School of Biomedical Science, who not only is in the field of neuroscience, but was also involved in choosing the topic of the symposium. All members of the audience are welcome to participate in the discussion by raising their hands. I implore for everyone to get involved by extrapolating mentioned concepts and opinions. TQ, if all speakers would like to.
Dangerous, counterproductive to individuals or societies. necessarily be stamped out as a matter of policy, but yeah, it could be dangerous. It's regularly dangerous,
because things have changed so much in the way how people communicate, I think. Things are a bit out of balance, and it seems like maybe we have to find a new balance. I really think the role of these gatekeepers used to be very important. It's different now, and I don't know what the answer is to get to more reasonable points again on some of these things. Sometimes I compare it with little children, right? Like, they're not going to be polite and well educated without good education. I mean, I have a 4-year-old now, and I'm trying to work on that. That's it's a bit of a challenge. But the question is really, and that may sound very paternalizing, and that's probably in itself a very dangerous message, but do adults need kind of constant education? It's a bit like the inoculation with booster shots regularly. And there may be, I mean, like, constant education is probably not the right way to think about it, but at least some kind of agreed upon morality or code, I think, is important. And I think, yeah, people who study morality would probably have much more to say about it.
You spoke about balance between rationality and rationality. Where do you think that lies? Maybe for people that on that is within society.
I think one of the things I was trying to capture with my talk was really the ways in which we think about things have effects, but they have effects in different ways. So, for example, you ask what the best song is. Can you come up with a rational reason for that? Or the way in which people dress. I mean, we look at things in the past and go, that's ridiculous. These might be irrational things, but they don't really have a significant impact. But also it shows that values are being tied up with ideas and truths. And we think rationality only that has its divorce from values is highly problematic, because values and facts are always interconnected. So there are clear spaces when it's okay to be rational, it's okay to be silly, that's not the point of things. But when we're talking about the use of information, the knowledge that can structure the way in which we treat others or the way in which we structure our societies in particular ways, they can be very dangerous. We just need to see the ways in which this language is being developed, the ways in which we treat asylum seekers today, when we have Amnesty International saying this amounts to torture, whereas the head of the Department of Border Protection and Immigration said that's nonsense. These have significant consequences, and whether that's rational or not, we need to be aware about how forms of knowledge influence that.
Are there any questions from the floor?
How would an individual go about realising when they're being irrational, and what steps do they take to reduce that rationality? And essentially that is someone at any point entitled to be irrational? I mean, particularly like you said, in what's your favourite song or in relationships, or like when you've got like a 4-year-old, are those the sort of only situations or are there more?
Well, I have to start by saying we have to stop thinking about I'm rational and you're irrational, okay? Because we all think we are rational, like we always think we're right. I have to argue with my son, he'll say he's right all the time, okay? So we've got to be careful about saying to other people who are irrational and we're rational, because by doing so, we're already blocking some kind of assessment. That's why I was trying to say that we need to understand what is the basis in which the meaning is made for them. Now, for people like anti-vaxxers, why is it that that is a rational view? Can step back. We can see that quite irrational, but why is it that they have formed that view? What is it that's going on for them that makes meaning for them? There are other things. So I have a PhD student who just finished looking at the way in which the internet is used to help frame choice about how we make decisions. And interestingly, so for example, like Yelp, for example, we go in and want to know which restaurant's the best for us, or does all these things, but what's the best mean? Now, what we see when we're looking at those two, at the way in which the internet helps us to structure and make choices, is we see two forms of knowledge operating. On the one side, you get websites that are like the Australian Consumer Choice Organisation Choice that provides independent scientific knowledge and says, these have been tested washing machines and they can provide the best capacity to clean our things at a good price, or that they're highly energy efficient. But we also see things like Yelp, where we crowdsource the knowledge. If to say that something is five-star, are we saying something's irrational? Are we saying that it's wrong? On what basis is that knowledge made, created? And we need to be aware that knowledge is that is a kind of experiential form of knowledge. And we need to be there. There are quite different modes of knowledge creation. And why is it that someone's knowledge creation, such as Andy Baxter, how does that come about? Versus how has come about in terms of whether such as the University of Queensland is the best university to go to versus Monash. So what do we mean when we're having truth statements?
But I also like to say though that in certain cases like the climate change denial, I think it's a bit clear what is rational and what is not rational, right? So I think there. So if things change, if some of those like different ideas that they may look like irrational come up, like change is not necessarily bad, but I think somebody mentioned like in terms of motivation or purpose, like if the common good is kind of under threat, like if irrationally we all go in a direction that will completely like get everything down the drain, then I think there is a problem. And so If somehow this idea of the common good can be brought into this value system of what is rational or valuable to do and what is not, then I would feel much more secure. But these days, sometimes it looks like that's not on the mind of people at all. And I think that can be dangerous.
I think the point that you say there is really that what we're doing is we're treating scientific knowledge as an opinion.
Yeah.
Like UQ is better than Monash, or that such and such restaurant is better than such and such. Yeah. We're treating it as an opinion rather than something that can be verified. And increasingly, that's how we treat scientific knowledge. So it's almost so Tony Abbott can say climate change is crap. On what basis is he saying that? He's got no authority. But that goes to the very fact that we've somehow undermine authority, we question authority, and we don't respect the expertise that some people will have. And that goes back to the social perspective about that we've had about over the last several decades. We've increasingly undermine authority, not necessarily of political authority or power authority, but knowledge authority, and just treated it more and more as an opinion. And that is highly problematic when we do that. We're treating a statement of truth in terms of scientific truth as something in terms of meaningful truth.
I think there's a tricky question there. If a community decides to do something which collectively harms it, and let's run with the assumption that that's what happens in Brexit, you've got different reasons that could arise. So you could have a movement for not vaccinating kids that got so far that it started affecting government policy, and that would be based on misinformation. Scientific facts. It's hard to imagine that there are people in the community motivated to have their children get diseases, and they're presumably making this decision. This was covered, how this can happen. They're getting bad information fed to them. They're believing the information they want to believe this kind of thing. So anti-vaccines is a case where probably you want the informed public, I don't know, overriding general public sentiment if it goes that far. If you look at something like Brexit, the people who voted for Brexit probably, clearly it was an irrational decision from a number of angles, but some of them weren't making a rational decision, wouldn't claim to. They were sentimental for the greatness of the British Empire. They don't want to be told by continental Europe what they should be doing. So in a sense, they would have volunteered that they're not making a rational decision, but wanted to make them all the same. And it looks like a pretty crazy thing to do, but how as a government or a society can you tell the difference between people's being willfully irrational but probably should be permitted in some cases, and when they're just simply making bad decisions because they don't know what they're doing.
I think, going back to those gatekeepers, I think it used to be the case that they were like a moderating factor, and like public TV, you would expect them to be impartial and with the eye for the scientific truth, and if that disappears, then you would hope that there is something else taking over that role, but I don't know what it will be. And of course, some of those gatekeepers were also rightfully criticized because they may have been biased too and things like that, but I think on violence, there was some kind of stabilizing factor from that, and that's now mostly gone, and I don't know where, how that can be replaced.
Well, that goes back to what we regard as experts, but also things like the mass media. There's research being done in the US that says people who watch Fox News actually know less about the world than people who watch no news. So it goes back to what is the nature of the news cycle and what is being used. So as an Australian, for example, is a more right-wing paper that presents certain topics and stories than say the Fairfax, but you get other media outlets that are very much focused on entertainment or shocking people, getting emotional responses. And when we move from that kind of merged kind of sense of what's factual or reporting things in an objective manner to something that becomes an op-ed piece, an opinion piece, that is driven by potentially paid-up subscribers for particular purposes, such as big coal, big tobacco, big pharma, then we actually realise that we're getting fed with stuff that is in the interest of particular groups, and that's why Marx called the term false consciousness, that we become, given the knowledge of the world view that those who are in power want us to have.
Now we can hear it seems that those with control over information dissemination are those in control of the information landscape. How can the public educate themselves when their source of information is so heavily biased?
I think it was going back to things that we were just talking about. So whom can you trust? And there a lot of the sources of information we have are either ignorant or biased or motivated.
I think in a democracy you always have to hope that at least 50% of the people won't decide on or choose to do stupid things. But I do think, and normally it is like that, so we don't have to be too much worried, but I think that the system is now much easier to manipulate, and then you can get more swings, and you can easily get more than 50% on the dark side of the... And so I think there is more risk in that sense. But you still have to hope that people are not stupid.
I'm just curious, are you aware of irrationality or like false like indebtedness? Because I would assume that you would be highly aware of this kind of irrationality, say in science or in your profession, but when you see our news when, say, Donald Trump is making dumb statement, would you make the effort to actually go on fact check and check that he is lying or someone in some politicians lying? Do you guys have this habit, or do you think it's possible that someone is extremely rational or extremely aware of irrationality in their profession, but being totally ignorant in daily life? Is this possible?
I think it's possible. I think it. My instinct is it would be rare. I mean, it's not necessarily to call it like a completely unqualified virtue, but scientists typically have signed on at least to the idea that rationality is a good thing. And then if they're provided with accurate information and if they're any good at applying rational thought, they'll probably follow a rational path. I think that would tend to soak through someone's professional and private life. I think a bigger problem is what information is out there. So if I see Donald Trump making a statement that I don't know the background, but it just sounds highly dubious, I'd go to one of my trusted sources, which would either be some of the remaining gatekeepers or some left-wing blog that I subscribe to. So then, again, am I turning to the right sources, or am I just reading the news that I want to read so that I can believe more strongly what I already believe? And then there's always evidence if all else fails. So if he says he didn't support the Iraq War, and then there's a clear statement of an interview where he's supporting the Iraq War, that overrides. Yeah. Ultimately, you'd like evidence, but I feel like it's hard.
Yeah. So Trump kind of inoculates his followers by saying all those sources of information that would give you a good view, he just says they are biased, don't listen to them. Right? And so then, and these days, like it's like what you were saying, I think, like the news that you see on Facebook is kind of, or it could be filtered towards your preferences, so you only see the things you actually want to see. And then it's very hard to get to the real trustworthy information.
Yeah, I just wondered, like the discussion before about science being interpreted as opinion interests me. I think I was wondering, do you think that there's an overall anti-intellectualism that's happening, particularly in the West, I suppose? And also, are you seeing anything or think of anything related to age and demographics in terms of fear and resistance to change, fear of the future? And I suppose the other question is about gender. Like, do you think that there is an higher tendency, for example, for white middle-aged males in America to be irrational than, say, democratic women, or women in America? There's this gender thing that's seemingly playing out in the US at the moment. Do you have any sort of views on that?
I
you're three men out there talking about irrationality, yeah. So that's why I was wondering about
well, I think like from a sociological perspective, we need to understand what our white males are doing, the working class males, the situation that they find themselves in the US. The median wages have been going backwards for about 15 years in the US. That means the average person had been falling behind. Now, that's not a phenomenon we see in Australia or most other OECD countries, but they've largely flatlined. But they're going backwards. So they're facing a circumstance where they feel that some groups of people are getting well ahead and they're not going anywhere, they're going backwards. So when you've got that sense that you're going backwards, something's to blame. Okay. So you look for reasons for this. You look for migrants that are coming in and taking your job as an explanation. You look for international globalization, so we're offshoring stuff. So car manufacturing is in decline and we're being replaced somewhere else in Korea. So you look for those things that are rational explanations. They may not be based on scientific research or anything, but they become a meaningful way in which to make meaning for that. And so again, the gender challenge changes in patriarchy, changes in and female empowerment is also challenging to those men who grew up in a way where these are the gender roles and this is how I position, this is how I feel that men and women work. Then if that's been changed, that also becomes part of the story in that why is it that men are responding in this particular way and then quite sexist in their conduct. And we see this occurring historically throughout time, that the shutting of boundaries, the highly sexist behaviour occurs at unequal times of economic deflation and stagnation. That's not to justify irrational behaviour, but that's to try to understand what it is that's driving that mode of thought. And so what they see is the elites have failed in their view. That's why Donald Trump is such light, because he's seen as not elite. It's ironic that someone who's a billionaire is not seen as an elite, but because he's not seen part of the establishment, he's seen as somehow coming outside and challenging the things that, saying the things that you can't, that elites won't say. Well, actually, they probably say it, but they did it in a dog whistle way. He's saying it directly. And I don't know whether that answers the question, but we need to understand that basis and where that's going from. And similarly, on Brexit, there was this similar kind of sentiment. Remember what happened in the UK
is a very strong sense of removing government services. When the government responded to austerity, it cut public services significantly.